So my next speaker is Mr. Vincent Dumézel, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce him. He is a very passionate individual. He is in the forefront of the seabed revolution. I had the pleasure of meeting Mr. Vincent. This was at the UN Ocean Conference, where he had the manifesto and he gave it to me, and you will hear a lot about him. But before I start, I'm going to probably read his bio. So Mr. Vincent is the senior advisor for the ocean for the United Nations Global Compact. He's the director of the Food Programs Lloyd's Register Foundation. With 20 years of experience in the food industry, Vincent is now the senior advisor of the United Nations Global Compact on Oceans, as well as the director for the Food Program for the Lloyd's Register Foundation. Vincent leads the charitable objectives of the foundation through the funding of innovative products, projects to support the food supply chain, partnering with the UN, FAO, the World Bank, WWF, universities, NGOs, and large brands. Vincent has led and released the seaweed manifesto in a call to scale up the seaweed industry in order to address some of the world's most important challenges: hunger, global warming, pollution, poverty. Vincent is now co-leading the first international platform for the seaweed stakeholders, the Safe Seaweed Coalition. He is also the UN Global Compact lead contact for the UN Food Systems Summit, and such activity, and he also actively supports the organization of the summit as well as the COP26 next fall. Thank you for being here for this really important event of the Ocean Decade for UN Ocean Decade for Sustainable Development. So I have a few questions for you. For those who don't know, you've been in the forefront of the seaweed revolution, and you've also released the Seaweed Manifesto. I would like you to tell us a bit about the Safe Seaweed Coalition and how you plan to actually solve these pressing problems, which are like global, which is global warming, hunger, pollution, and of course, poverty. So please, Mr. Vincent, the stage is yours.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation to speak. It's always a pleasure to work with you, Runa. And I still appreciate your work. So it's an honor for me to be here speaking with you. We will solve the problem of this generation, and it can only be all together. And when I say all together, that the basic objective of this coalition that we have set up is to get together. But let me step back a bit maybe and give some perspective about, what is the potential of seaweed? Well, actually, seaweed has quite an unlimited potential. I think there are so many different types of seaweed. First, we know at least 12,000 types of seaweed, and we have learned to cultivate, we have domesticated only 10 or 20 of them at the maximum. The total surface, the total area where seaweed production is possible is around 66 million square kilometers. And today we are cultivating less than 2,000 square kilometers out of 66 million. So, I mean, we are nowhere. And I keep saying the same, we are in the Stone Age. We moved from prehistory to modern history when we stopped being hunter-gatherers back 12,000 years ago and became farmers. And civilization, it's all about farming. It's all about managing the ecosystem to produce more and to make sure it is regenerative. We have not done that for the ocean so far. We are nowhere in the ocean. We are just dumping our waste in the ocean. And then opportunistically, we are trying to hunt, or we call that fishing, or gather wild seaweed. In the meantime, we are destroying this ecosystem. And to talk about sustainable ocean now is a bit irrelevant to me, because when you have destroyed over 50% of the biodiversity in an ecosystem, you're not talking about sustainability, you're not talking about preserving, you are talking about restoring, regenerating, and that's where we are. And if you look at the ecosystem in the ocean, seaweed is the basic, it's the lowest trophic. So seaweed, dissolved seaweed, will feed the lowest trophic level, phytoplankton, filters, and so forth. And then they will, this one will feed small fish or bivalves, and they will then feed big fish, and so forth. So that's why it's important, first of all. We are in the Stone Age, and seaweed is the really basic of the ocean. What is the potential of seaweed? Unlimited, actually, because, I mean, seaweed can be a source of food. I mean, very, very nutritional food, very, very important. a lot of fatty acids, of iron, of proteins, more than anything else. A lot of vitamin B12, vitamin C, vitamin K, and zinc, and so forth, and low fat, and very good stuff for all of us. Can be a source of feed, can be with a lot of interesting side effects, like increased immune resistance of the animal, lower the need for antibiotics, or decrease the methane emission by quite large, which is a big, big problem for greenhouse gas in the world. Can be, seaweed can also be a source of biostimulants, so increase the resistance of the plant. It can be a source of biopackaging, of textile, of medicines. We can do many, many different things with seaweed. We can restore man's sight, actually. They manage to do that. So there's an unlimited number of innovation. It can also sequester carbon. And actually, that's the only food or only resource that has a negative impact, because while it grows, it sequesters in the ocean because it's losing skin, it's losing cells, just like we are doing with our skin. It's losing cells while it grows, and these cells are carbon that are sunk in the ocean for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. So as such, it is a negative emission product, which is very rare. It cleans the ocean, it protects the shores because it limits the erosion of the shore. It supports livelihood, notably women. We see that in emerging countries, mostly women are benefiting from seaweed, and we see a large majority of women involved in the seaweed supply chain, even in developed countries, which is totally an exception in the world of the ocean. But if you look at fishermen, I'm not sure you will find a lot of fisherwomen, actually. So that's quite interesting in terms of gender parity and women empowerment. So the big question that comes next is, why is it not happening already? Why is it not there already? I mean, there's so many problems that it can address. And the main question, I think, is the lack of coordination and the lack of collaboration. So that's why we have funded with the Lloyd Fujita Foundation, with the UN Global Compact, we have funded the first ever global coalition for seaweed, so Save Seaweed Coalition. You can all register for free there. If you are interested to know more about seaweed, to exchange with others, saveseaweedcoalition.org, just register there, it's free. You can display what you're doing, you have an interactive tool. And the idea is really, I mean, of course, we will fund some project on this coalition. We'll fund some project to improve standards, safety standards for the product, for the environment, and for the workers in this supply chain. Not that it is dangerous or unsafe. The thing is that there's no consistency in terms of standards, and that is preventing the scale up of this industry. And it's not consistent, because there is no one voice to speak on behalf of the seaweed industry. And here we are. I mean, we want to speak for this voice and say we need consistent standards. We need consistent regulation in order to scale up. And then we can start to think about how to scale up the production, how to ease permitting, how to raise awareness by population about all the fantastic things you can do about seaweed, educate people, eat more seaweed, use seaweed for textile, use seaweed for many different things. But the basic thing is standardized regulation, because if you don't have this, then your product, you cannot just put your product on the market. And once again, there's a lot to do on this. So that would be the first step. But you can get a lot of seaweed, you can eat a lot of seaweed, use a lot of seaweed already. There are fantastic projects. There's a real momentum. Jeff Bezos granted $100 million to support seaweed. There's a huge project in West Africa for Southwest Africa for $65 million. There's a lot of investors that are looking to invest into seaweed. They are also looking for a direction, who I could speak with if I want to invest in seaweed. They had no partner to do that. Here we are as well. We want to be the one to speak with the investors and tell them, well, you can invest there, you can invest there, you can invest here, and so forth. That's our objective, is to represent this very, very nascent seaweed industry. And I'm not talking in that example for the North Asia, for the Asia, I mean, because in China, Korea, Philippines, and so forth, they are quite educated and quite in advance. They are producing a lot of seaweed, 30 million tons of seaweed, fast-growing business there. But in the rest of the world, in the South Asia and in the rest of the world, we are totally in the Stone Age. We are in the prehistory, so we need to move to civilization of the ocean. We need to reconnect our land with our ocean.
Yeah, it's true. Seaweed is definitely one of those mysteries that connects medicine, nutrition. It's important for the climate. And I just got off one of your talks with the World Chef, and I still remember you saying that it's a kelp forest. It's not, and the difference between the plant, the seaweed plant, and the seaweed. Correct?
The sea plants there are some sea plants that are growing in the shore, and they are not seaweed because the seaweed doesn't have any roots, doesn't have any flowers. So, but you have some plants that are growing near shore. So there's still a confusion. But more importantly, I think a strong message to deliver is that seaweed is an appropriate name. It's not weed. It's nothing to do with weed. It can grow up to 30 centimeters a day, up to 60 meters. You can feed people with this. It can have many different tastes. It is a wide diversity of organism. The difference between a green seaweed and a red seaweed is bigger than the difference between a fungi and an elephant from a genetic point of view. That amplifies the number of applications that you can do with this. So let's call them sea vegetables, because we need to speak about feeding people with them. Let's talk about sea forests, because they are protecting biodiversity. They are sequestering carbon by large. And when you have organisms which are 60 meters high, it's not weed, it's a forest. And then maybe people will think about protecting the forest or reforesting, you know, just like we do with our land and with our forests on land. We need to, because seaweed are endangered at the moment. They are disappearing very fast because of biodiversity problems, because of ecosystem disruption. They are disappearing by large. And in California, which was a big forest of seaweed there, 80% of the kelp are gone. They are disappeared. And then there you just have desert because there's nothing there. And when you think about it, this ocean ecosystem, it contributes to 50% of the oxygen we breathe. So if we lose this ocean biodiversity, we might be in big, big trouble.
Absolutely. And I also want to kind of take away from what you just mentioned in your just like a few minutes earlier, where you said that women are also being benefited by this, because we know, like with the SDGs, you have SDG 5, which is gender equality.
Absolutely.
And you also have a big problem when it comes to disparity, especially when it is also with the coastal communities, number one, facing challenges because of commercial fishing practices, and it's the same thing with the women. So how does this industry, the seaweed industry or the seaweed revolution, also help revolutionize women's lives?
Well, it's quite straightforward, actually, because the thing is that the seaweed business is usually done by the fisherman's wife. So the fishermen, they go at sea and there's no fish left, actually. They are overfishing. If we would give all the subsidies in the world, I think subsidies in the world for fishermen are 20 billion per year. So we give 20 billion a year to pay people for overfish and to extinct species, which is, let's give them to those women who are working in the seaweed business. And the thing is that the fishermen are trying to fish, but they have no revenue out of it. So the fisherman's wife, they are actually, because seaweed doesn't need any investment. You just put ropes on the ocean. You don't need any specific training. You don't need to be literate. And actually, unfortunately, a lot of women in emerging countries are illiterate, which is quite a problem as well. So, but you don't need many knowledge to. You just need to put these ropes. You put some seeds. It grows again and again in Tanzania, for instance. And you don't need to reseed. It grows again. You harvest. It grows again. It grows again. And then you just let it dry on the beach, because and once it is dry, you can keep them for months. So it's a very simple business with very limited investment and very limited training required. So, and once again, it's easy for fishermen who are losing their revenues to ask their woman, their wife, to do this. And that's how it happened, actually. And now, once again, in Tanzania, you have 80% to 90% of the revenues that are going to women. And we're not talking only about women collecting seaweed on the beach. We are talking about all these processing part and about all this academic part. I mean, the head of the cluster in flower, Ansuya, is the head of the cluster industry for seaweed in Tanzania. It's a woman. And even in the rest of the world, there's an amazing number of women who are CEOs of seaweed companies. And I was at a call the other day, and there was 8 panelists, and I was the only male actually there. And there were 7 women with me. They were all CEOs and so forth. And the main conclusion of this panel session was to create a network of female which are in charge for seaweed development, and we would call them the SheWeed, you know. And I think that's in progress. I mean, I maybe they proposed me to be the only honorary male to be part of this panel, but I'm not sure if I should accept this. But anyway, I think they are. But I think it's interesting. Yeah, really, because de facto, I mean, you have a large majority of women who are working in this industry.
Yeah, very interesting. It reminds me of when we met at the United Nations for the Ocean Conference, and I had this sustainable line that I came up with. And the funny thing is that I actually employed only women who learned the technique, which mitigated water pollution and water wastage. So, and I use seaweed, and you told me it was seaweed. So it was a great.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
it was a great connection. That brings me to my next question. I have shared with you some of the seaweed dresses that were made, which were made by this one particular seaweed. And we've also heard that there's kind of distrust when it comes to biomass or biomaterials used. And how do you plan to break through with this, especially with the connection with food and fashion? You know, because we know that seaweed can also be processed into textiles. But generally, how do you break the mindset of people to understand that not all biomass is bad, but it can also be used for the good for the environment?
Well, I think that's exactly what we want to convey as a message. I mean, so far, if you look at this industry in Tanzania, in Philippines, and in Southeast Asia, we see that they are only using seaweed for the carrageenan, and they waste the rest of it. While it's full of nutrients, it's full of interesting polymers, it's full of interest. So the next step for us is to be able to have biorefinery who can really split the various compounds so we can valorize each of them. So we can really have a resource that will be, once again, regenerative, because while it grows, seaweed restore biodiversity. So it's regenerative as such. And then if you harvest it, you can split it in various compounds, notably in textile, because it has interesting polymer for textile. And then valorize it in a different way and then the farmers, the women, they have more money. Another project in Namibia who is expected to do that. I mean, exactly. It's the largest seaweed farm. I mean, it's not yet there, but they are planning to open in Namibia the largest seaweed farm in the world, hundreds of hectares, actually. It will sequester as much carbon as the entire emission of the Netherlands, actually, when it will be up and running full scale. And the biomass that we produce there will be for textile and functional food mostly, and a bit for fertilizers. So it's a great source, and art is so important. I mean, because we need to convince people that seaweed is really cool. It's something really good. It's a fantastic food, but it has other properties. It's not the slimy, smelly, and unsexy thing that you walk into when you are at the beach. You know, that's much more than this. It has a lot of properties. I mean, yeah, it's time to get over this feeling that it's, art is the only way to do that. Art is so good at telling stories. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm fully convinced about all, I mean, I'm into art as well. I'm a musician, and I'm fully convinced about the power of that. Unfortunately, we have not yet designed guitars in using seaweed, but I'm sure we will find a way. But I think art is a fantastic way to tell stories, to show people that what they first perceive as something invasive, dangerous, and smelly and salty can be something really, really cool and really good. And I think that's why it's so important, the work that you are doing, and that's why I'm so glad to support you, because, I mean, promoting that And I keep, I don't have it with me, but I keep displaying some, during my talk, normally I'm displaying some piece of things like, looks like wood or like things which looks like plastic glasses. And they are all made of seaweed, you know. And that is so powerful to display this kind of polymer or this kind of object. Because that's really convincing. People see, wow, that's made of seaweed, but that looks like wood. That looks like, and this piece of this building brick that is made out of seaweed is 3 times stronger, harder than oak, actually. So it can really be interesting. So there are so many different uses, and I think the work you're doing with textile is such a fascinating work, and I think there's a lot to do into that. And we are at the very, very beginning. For art, for fashion, but even to replace textile, we know that cotton is a very unsustainable production. We know it needs a lot of pesticides, a lot of water, and so forth. So let's stop using cotton. I mean, we've got a lot of seaweed to grow. So let's do it.
I completely agree. And I do not think seaweed is unsexy or slimy. I think it's one of the most beautiful things I've ever come across. And thanks to you, I've learned so much from you and everyone who's listening, the most enigmatic person, Mr. Vincent. I've learned so much about seaweed. And if you want to learn more about seaweed, please get into the safeseaweedcoalition.org. My other question, since I'm a fashion designer, I have to ask you this. And I do a lot of activation, right, to kind of get people to be engaged with, to understand products like seaweed and how it can actually help people and the environment. I would like to hear from you. What were the thoughts that came into your mind when you saw the collection? And what is to you the connection between fashion and food?
Well, I mean, fashion or getting dressed and food is one of the basic needs that we have, first of all. I mean, we need to get warm and we need to get fed. That's what we need. So that's two basic needs. So if seaweed can fulfill these two basic needs in a way or another, that's so cool. And of course, you can use it for functional dress or for functional food. You can also use it for gastronomy or fashion, as you do. I think that's the same. I mean, they are all the same. And but to get to it, I mean, we need a lot of activism indeed, and we need some activist people. That's why I'm talking about a seaweed revolution, because it's a full mindset that needs to be broken. I mean, we have this wrong perception about seaweed, but the thing is that we are all activists. We are all environmental activists at the end of the day. I mean, each time we buy something in a shop, whether it is to get dressed or to get food or each time we click on something we like, I mean, we are environmental activists. We are, people are looking at what we are doing. That we know that we live in a world that is fully connected now. And we are all connected to the same garment system, to the same food system. And people are monitoring what we are doing, what our choice are. And each time we drink and we buy something, we are environmental activists. 4 times a day, we are environmental activists and we shape the world we want. So let's do it all together, and we have to be activists. And we are all part of this revolution. You are leading the pack in terms of the fashion part. I mean, we are trying to support for the food part, but we are all working in the same direction, which is to give a different perspective to seaweed and make people understand that it is the greatest untapped resource we have on the planet at the moment. And that it can really address the generational challenges that we have.
Yeah, perfect. The perfect coalition between this exactly. is with the coalition. This is exactly, you just summed it out perfectly. Perfect.
Exactly.
So my last question to you is, now this program is to do with an engaging and inspiring ocean. And you are an engaged and a very inspiring person yourself. So I would like to hear from you, in your words, what does an engaging and inspiring ocean mean to you personally?
Well, we should once again reconnect land and ocean. This is not parallel system. This is not different system, and we should reconnect them. They work. It's a global ecosystem. So engaging, it should be connected with the land, because seaweed has the potential to clean the agricultural runoff, for instance, and they will provide compounds of interest for plants and for animals and for humans. So it's all a circular economy. And I think an engaging and inspiring influence would be all a circular economy, but a regenerative one once again. We should stop this extractive aquaculture, this fishing industry that we have, which is in a predator. We are a predator in the ocean. So we should stop that. I mean, we should be managing the ecosystem. We should develop a permaculture in the ocean, a regenerative system with multi-trophic aquaculture that are regenerating themselves and that support the land, that support life on land. And I think that's the way forward. And that's what is an inspiring and engaging ocean is to me. Totally regenerative, permaculture in the ocean, ecosystem services for ocean and for land. We have not been very good at telling story when it comes to the ocean so far. It is absent in most of the strategic discussion. There's no UN organization for the ocean, for instance. Why? What is there anything more international than the ocean? I mean, is there anything more cross-country than the ocean? But no, but there's nothing more. But there's no UN organization for this. So I think we have to tell stories. We are and art and food, and there's very good ways to tell story. And we need to inspire and engage people through the stories to reconcile land and ocean and make them work all together to sustain a world of 10 billion people, because that's what it will be at least. So, and to sustain and to feed and dress these people in a safe and sustainable way, which will also mitigate climate change, which will restore biodiversity and support livelihoods and notably women. That's the engaging and inspiring story that I have for the ocean.
Fantastic, Mr. Wasso. Nobody could have said it better. It was beautiful. I always learn a lot whenever I speak to you. So everything is really inspiring. So you're going to be at the COP26?
Yes. We'll be pushing hard for this on the UN Food System Summit and the UN Ocean Summit as well. So yeah, we are pushing hard, and also with the private sector and the NGOs and the academics. We need, and support primary production. Yeah, because things are not only happening in these UN meetings, and a lot has to be done on the ground and boots on the ground or boots on the ocean, I would say.
Yeah, so hopefully we can meet each other then. Hopefully everything should be clear.
Hopefully, yes.
Yeah.
Fingers crossed.
It was lovely having this discussion with you. And
my pleasure.
Looking forward to a lot more that can be done with seaweed, with the intersection with art, food, fashion, clothing, and the circularity and the systems that can be put into place. Thank you so much for taking this time and being a part of this really important event. And I wish the Seaweed Revolution and the Safe Seaweed Coalition all the best.
Thank you very much. Wish you all the best as well.